Pray together. Father, as we pray, as we come to open your word and share the word together, remind us what we just said, that in Jesus we are never the same again. May he speak to our hearts today. May we have ears to hear and hearts open to listen and to take in and apply. Speak to us, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Today we're going to start looking at some personal encounters with Jesus. Those instances, those people that he met as he ministered among us, and those personal one-on-one encounters that he had. Our first encounter is with a person that most of us have known all of our lives. We've known this person because he is one of the first Bible stories we learned as children if you went to church as a kid. One of those first ones, and you learned about him by singing a little song. Now, I'm going to be preaching this morning about Zacchaeus. And you all know the song. Right now, as soon as I said Zacchaeus, it's bouncing around in your head. So, in order to get that out of the way, so you're not singing that song in your head the rest of the message, stand with me, please. I brought some friends along to help us sing this morning.
Here we go.
Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and the wee little man was he.
Really little.
He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see.
Hello.
And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree.
And he said, Zacchaeus, you come down.
Well, I'm going to your house
today. Yes, I'm going to
your house. That's pretty good. Let's do it again.
Hey, what's with the Egyptian thing?
Now you're smiling.
Here we go.
Here we go.
One more time.
Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he.
Very tiny.
He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see.
There he is.
And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree.
And he said, Zacchaeus, you come down.
For I'm going to your house today.
Hey, hey.
For I'm going to your house today.
See if you can get it right. The hand motions. I saw the hand motions up here.
Look at me go. Look at me go.
Oh, Zacchaeus was a wee little man. But a happy little man was he. Zacchaeus saw the Lord that day. And a happy little man was he. As the Savior passed his way, he looked up in the tree.
And he said, Zacchaeus, you come down.
And a happy little man was he. Yes, a happy little man was he.
All right, have a seat, have a seat. Well, you're awake, and you're finally smiling. And with that in mind, now that you have that out of your head, turn with me to Luke chapter 19. In the 19th chapter of Luke, we read the story of Zacchaeus, one of the personal encounters of Jesus, and one that we all know, but is very, very, very pointed about us and how we live our Christian life. Luke chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. The personal encounter with Jesus. Then Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. Now behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus who was the chief tax collector, and he was rich. And he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, for he was of short stature. So he ran ahead and climbed up into the sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. So he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. But when he saw it, they all complained, saying, he has gone to be the guest with a man who is a sinner. Then Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, look, Lord, I give half of my goods to the poor, and if I have taken anything from anyone by false accusation, I restore fourfold. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. This story is set in the context of Jesus going to Jerusalem. He is moving toward the cross. He is moving toward the resurrection. But he is moving toward Jerusalem and encountering people along the way. If you back up in chapter 18, in verse 31, it tells us that he took the 12 aside and told them, behold, we are going to Jerusalem. All things that are written by the prophet concerning the Son of Man will be accomplished. For he will be delivered to the Gentiles and be mocked and insulted and spit upon. They will scourge him and kill him. And the third day he will rise again. And so it is very, very pointed what he is doing. There is no happenstance here. There is no coincidence on the road. Jesus is moving on purpose. He has set his face to go to Jerusalem, and he is headed there because it is what God has sent him to do. And so with that in mind, as he moves toward Jerusalem, he comes to Jericho. And the latter part of chapter 18, he heals a blind man as he comes into Jericho. The crowd didn't want the blind man calling out to Jesus, but he calls out all the more, and Jesus heals him. He restores his sight. And it is in that context then, keep that in mind, as he moves toward Jerusalem, that Jesus, when he passes through Jericho, enters or encounters Zacchaeus. Look with me at the verses. As he entered and passed through Jericho, behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, and he has two strikes against him here. He was a tax collector, and he was rich. Now, if you were rich in Jesus' day, that was a good thing. Everybody looked up to you. You know, if you remember when the rich man encountered Jesus, the rich young ruler, the disciples, when he went away sorrowful and Jesus said it's hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom, the disciples said, well, then who could be saved? Because a rich man was the epitome of what you wanted to be in Jesus' day. Sounds a little familiar, doesn't it? But in his day, and so it's not bad to be a rich man except if you're a tax collector. And when I say tax collector, what you should go is, ooh, because he's the bad guy. Tax collectors are bad guys because they would take the tax that they were supposed to take, and then anything they could get above and beyond that, they could keep. And so he would gouge the people with their taxes, and they were hated. So he has two strikes against him. He's a tax collector, and because he's a tax collector, he's a rich man. He got his riches by being dishonest with the people. So we see that right above that. Now, verse 3 tells us he sought to see who Jesus was, but could not because of the crowd, because he was short in stature. The crowds would come to Jesus. They would flock to him, and he couldn't see through the crowd. And so he ran ahead, climbed up in a sycamore tree to see him, for he was going to pass that way. Now, people in trees was not unusual. Even today, we see that. Crowds come around. They'll get up on light poles. They'll stand up on things. They'll try to see what's going on. What's unusual is the encounter Jesus has with Zacchaeus. Now, he comes there, and we don't know what information Zacchaeus had about Jesus before this. We do know that earlier in Luke, in the early chapters of Luke, Jesus called a tax collector to be one of his disciples. Ouch! Boy, that really was thinking outside the box. And so no doubt that circled real quickly around the tax collecting community. So no doubt Zacchaeus had heard about Jesus, and now he got to see him come through his town. So he wanted to at least see him as he passed by. And when Jesus came to the place in verse 5, it says, he looked up and saw him and said to him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must stay at your house. It's interesting to me what Jesus did here. Not just that he looked up and saw him in this tree, because a short man in a tree would stand out, even though others were around, but that he fixed his eyes on him. There was a rapport built between the two. And then he said, come down hurriedly, because I'm coming to your house. He's inviting him to Zacchaeus' house. It's an interesting encounter, because what Jesus doesn't do, as he looks at Zacchaeus, He knows he's a tax collector. They had their own look. They had their own dress. And he knew who he was. And so what he didn't say to Zacchaeus was, Zacchaeus, get yourself straightened out. Get your life in order. Get it together, man. And then I'll come to your house. He didn't say that, did he? He says, Zacchaeus, make haste. Come on down here because today I'm coming to your house. Now, that seems strange to us. I've tried to invite myself to some of your houses and you haven't picked up on it yet. You know, I say things like, I like pie. I like ice cream. But Jesus in his day is inviting himself to a house of someone who never, ever has anyone want to come to his house except other tax collectors. And so Jesus invites himself. And Zacchaeus jumps down out of his tree. And look what happens after that. He made haste and came down and received him joyfully. Now, there's a subtle shift in the text here. Because what happens, what we don't see, is that Jesus goes to his house because there's an encounter then at his house with those who are surrounding Jesus in the crowd. When they saw it, when they saw that he had received him, that Jesus had come to his house, that he was interacting with him one-on-one, they started to complain. They being those around him. They being perhaps some of the disciples, perhaps some of the others, but mainly religious folks around him. When they saw it, they all complained, saying, he has gone to be a guest with a man who is a sinner. Ooh, that's a terrible thing. Why would you want to spend time with someone who was a sinner? And then something miraculous happens. In the text, it's verse 8. Zacchaeus stands up and he says to Jesus, look, Lord, I give half of my goods to the poor, and if I've taken anything from anybody by false accusation, I restore fourfold. What we don't hear here is Jesus getting to Zacchaeus' house and starting a long sermon to Zacchaeus about how he's supposed to shape up. Jesus, by his presence, goes with Zacchaeus, and by his presence of accepting him and wanting to be a part of Zacchaeus' life, Zacchaeus is convicted. He begins to change his own life because of the presence of Jesus in him. Look how Jesus reacts to that. Today, salvation has come to this house because he also is a son of Abraham. Reminding those around here that Zacchaeus was also one of the covenant people, one of God's chosen. For, Jesus says, the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. Jesus knew his ministry and knew by his presence and by his acceptance of Zacchaeus where he was that salvation could come, and that's why he came. After this passage, Jesus gives the parable of the talents. Verse 11 says, and when they heard these things, he spoke another parable because he was near Jerusalem and because they thought the kingdom of God would appear immediately. And he tells the story of a nobleman who goes to another country to receive a kingdom. And he gives out money to his 10 servants, and he comes back, and there's a reckoning for those talents. And you know the story very well, but at the end of that story, verses 26 and 27, it says, for I say to you that everyone who has will be given, and for him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. Bring here those enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them and slay them before me. That's a graphic image. Jesus is going to Jerusalem, and he's saying that God has a time of reckoning, and what's going to happen, you have to deal with, because God is not happy with where man is. Now, the point of the story is not that. That's for another time. But here, look with me about what Zacchaeus says to us, this personal encounter with Jesus. What do you see in this well-known story that we can apply to our lives today? Do you see yourself in the story? You may very well today be up your own tree, curious about Jesus, wanting to know more, but your lifestyle, your problems, your issues, your background, those kind of things are keeping you at a distance. You're not sure whether you can come into his presence because of all the stuff in your life. To that, Jesus looks up and sees you. He knows and extends the same invitation to you right where you are to come. Jesus doesn't say, clean up, get right, and then I'll come to you. Jesus says, make haste, come down, for today I must stay at your house. He invites you to come today. He invites you into his presence. Will you accept his invitation today? Will you let him come in right here, right now, and simply say, Jesus, I don't understand it all, but I know you love me, you died for me, and I know I'm a sinner. I've done ungodly things, I've thought ungodly things, I've lived a life that's not pleasing to God. Here's my life. He's offering that invitation for you today. Will you come? Personal encounter with Jesus. Do you see yourself here? You're a believer. You know that Jesus has saved you. However, there's stuff going on in your life that you know is not godly. There is the need to get real and get right with him, but you're not sure. This morning, Jesus is looking up at you in your tree and says, make haste, come down, for today I must stay at your house. Look at it this way. Jesus was coming and offers to come and clean house at your house. Will you accept his invitation today? Will you say, today's going to be the day that I get it together for him? And all I have to do is let him come into my life today. Will you come? A personal encounter with Jesus. Jesus calls us to him, but he also calls us, listen to this, Jesus also calls us to be him in our world. This encounter with Zacchaeus, if it's only about salvation, if it's only about me personally, we've missed the point. Because this is Jesus calling us to be Jesus in our world. That means that we have to see as he sees. We have to do as he does. What do you see? When you look up to in the trees of our world, who do you see? Who do you see that needs that invitation of Jesus? Who is there? Who is curious? Who is lovely? Or who is unlovely? Who needs someone to look up and see them? Well, perhaps it's the IRS. I mean, the tax man isn't loved today either. I hear a lot of complaints every April 15th. Maybe more pointedly, when we look up in that tree, we may see someone who's homeless. And it's easy for us to walk around the other side of the road and do nothing other than shake our head and move along quickly. Perhaps that man is up his tree looking for Jesus. Perhaps it's someone who we're not really comfortable being around, of another faith, another religion. Pastor James talks about reaching the Muslims. What do? Well, we just try to stay away, don't we? Many of them are up a tree wanting to see Jesus and don't know it. What do you see when you look up that tree? Do you see someone who's gay and you just quickly roll away? What do you see? And how do you encounter them? Do we say, get your act together, clean up, and then we'll come talk to you about Jesus? No, that's not what Jesus did. What do you see when you look up in that tree today? For some of you, if you looked up that tree and saw a Democrat, you would not only run, you'd throw something at him. Now, that's funny, but it's not. Because that represents someone that we're not willing to see because they're different than we are politically. What do you see when you look up in that tree? I hear a lot of us looking up in that tree and complaining about those people in Washington. But just perhaps, those who Jesus are wanting us to see. Maybe it's someone who's rich, got it all together. I have a friend who pastored in Philly with them. They were in the church, and then they went to Wisconsin. He retired, and he went to work for a church in Cincinnati, Ohio. This church was a specific ministry to the up and out. We always talk about the down and out, up and out. They met in some schools and stuff, but they finally bought their own property. They bought a golf course for $18.5 million. One member gave them $14.5 million to buy it. They reached the up and out. They had their skyboxes and all that stuff. And Phil told me, he said, what's interesting about that is they have all the money in the world and they're more miserable than people I've known who were poor. Up and out. But we let them stay in the tree because they got it all together. Perhaps we have our own prejudices about those who are up and out. Or maybe it's someone like our Jewish friends. There's a lot of anti-Semitism in us and in our world. But they're up a tree needing to see Jesus. And by the way, it could be Palestinians too that are up that tree that we're not seeing. Or maybe it's a young person in our family or in our home. A young boy or a young girl or a teenager that just gives us every attitude in the world. None of our kids would ever do that. Maybe they're the ones in the tree Jesus wants us to see. Or perhaps it's a spouse, a husband, or a wife that we're not willing to see through the eyes of Jesus, but they're up a tree looking for some significance in life. Maybe it's an older person in our family or in a nursing home that needs someone to see them in their tree of despair. Maybe someone from a different ethnic culture, a background, or even someone who frightens us. What are we willing to see? Are we willing to have the eyes of Jesus and look up in the trees and see the people around us and do what Jesus did? Now let's get real for a minute. All that's good and they're nice pictures and they may tug at us a little bit, but it really gets real when we talk about the people in our daily lives, our family and others, that you will not forgive nor will you accept, and you have all the right reasons for your position because all the things they've done or haven't done. But if you let Zacchaeus speak to you, Jesus blows you out of the water because he doesn't go to Zacchaeus, one of those who was in his family of faith, and say, get your act together. Start living right. Start acting right. Then I'll come to you. Jesus does an acceptance. And may we also say forgiveness. We want to qualify our redemption. We want to tell people in our lives to get cleaned up, get right, and then we will accept you and include you and love you. But that's not Jesus' way. Notice what he did. He saw Zacchaeus, he met him where he was, and he allowed, get this, he allowed God to work in his life for his life change. You know, I'll be honest with you. There's people in my family, people in my sphere of influence that I would like to clean them up. I really would. Man, I'd run them through the mill. Get them cleaned up physically, emotionally, spiritually, every which way you think of, I'd like to clean them up. But I'm reminded of that old saying, and it's a bumper sticker, but it's true. If you're a fisher of men, you catch them, God will clean them. But we want to clean them before we catch them. Here, Jesus, through Zacchaeus, is telling us, look up in that tree. Who in your life needs you to be Jesus to them right now? And it's not easy. Do you think Zacchaeus lived a perfect life after he was done this? You think he never, ever again got on the shady side? We don't know. But we know that in Jesus, salvation came to his house. Do we believe deeply that we can love someone and then let God work in their heart and let God bring the change? Today, Jesus said, I must stay at your house. Will you allow that to happen in you? And will you be Jesus today? Let's pray together. Father, in the Word. You give us some real challenges. Father, this is a story we've known all of our lives. It's a cute little song to sing, but it's powerful in the message that Jesus gives us. And as we've noted, Father, here, there are some of us here today who are curiously looking for Jesus. And Lord, by the power of your Holy Spirit, I pray that right now they hear your voice saying, come. Come down. I want to come to your house today and say yes to him. Father, some of us who have made that commitment are dealing with some stuff in our lives and we're just not sure. And to them, Jesus is looking and saying, come. Let me come clean up house. And Lord, for some of us, if we are personally honest today, we've looked up in the trees around us and we've seen people not like us, or people who don't like us, or people who aren't living like us. We've done a lot of judging and very little Jesus in their lives. Lord, work in our hearts in these moments, in Jesus' name. Amen. This time of invitation is a time that we invite you to come. The altar will be open to pray. Perhaps there's some people that are in your life that Jesus is challenging you to see and be Jesus to, and you want to come and talk with him about that. You may want to come here this morning, and I'll be standing here if you need someone to pray with you about accepting Jesus. You don't need someone to do that, but I would be glad to help you do that. And just say, yes, Jesus, I know you're inviting me to come. I come today. And you may be saying, well, this is the place God's led me. Here is the place for me to serve. And come and join us as part of Wrightsdale. Whatever God is saying to you in your tree this morning, hear Jesus inviting you to come. Let's stand together as we sing, Lord, here am I.
Master, thou callest, I gladly obey. Only direct me, and I'll find thy way. Teach me the mission appointed for me. What is my labor and where it shall be? Master, thou callest, and this I reply, ready and willing, Lord, here am I. Willing, my Savior, to take up the cross, willing to suffer reproaches and loss, willing to follow if thou wilt but lead. Only support me with grace in my need. Master, thou callest, and this I reply, ready and willing, Lord, hear.
As we continue this invitation, the altar is open. You may come.
Living or dying, I still would be thine. Yet I am mortal, while thou art divine. Pardon whenever I turn from the right. Pity and bring me again to the light. Master, thou callest, and this I reply, ready and willing, Lord.
together, let me invite you back tonight at 7 o'clock. Pastor James is going to be here to share with us. He's got a lot to share. We're allowed to be here till midnight. But I'm looking forward to hearing you share with us, brother, and some question and answer time. Right now, we invite you to Bible study. There's a class for every age for you to study deeper into God's Word. We invite you to be a part of that. After that, church council is going to meet up in the conference room. So you want to be there, and there's lots of things going on today, but be back tonight at 7 o'clock. Let's pray together. Father, it's good to be in your house. But Lord, it doesn't mean anything if we don't take what you've said to us and use it in our lives. So help us to look up into the trees this week, Father, to see those around us, in our families, in our lives, in our world, that need to see Jesus, and may we be him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.